Alright, so what I want to do is discuss a little bit about regression testing. So we're going to look at a traditional legacy view, what it is, why we do it, how we do it, and also then I want to look at regression testing in terms of modern system development. Okay, so regression testing, this is a common testing phrase. What is regression testing? Well, traditionally, what we're talking about is when a system regresses to a former or less developed state, a more primitive state. Now, I don't actually like the term regression testing, but let's stick with this at the moment. The system is going to regress to a former or less developed state. So what then is regression testing, if that's the definition of regression? Well, what we mean is testing parts of the system that we've already tested when the system changes. So we change part of the system, then, and we test that properly. Then we go, well, you know, something else might happen, so let's test the rest of the system. And that rest of the system is regression testing. So why would we do that? Why, we've just tested the change, why would we do regression testing? Because the change might have had an unexpected impact on another part of the system. Systems are big, they have interconnected components. We've changed one part, it might have impacted the others. So we do regression testing. So when do we do regression testing? Pretty much whenever we make a change. If we make a change, if we think there might be change impacted somewhere else, we do regression testing. That's what we do. So how do we do regression testing? So the legacy view of how we do regression testing is, well, we've already tested it. So what we'll do is we'll rerun those tests again. So if we have tests in another area, we'll rerun those tests. If we've got test cases, we'll rerun those test cases. If we've written scripts, we'll rerun those scripts. If we're doing exploratory testing, we'll do exploratory testing in those areas again. How else might we do it? Because very often when we're talking about regression testing, we're talking about test automation. So we could run the automated execution in those areas. Hopefully, the automated execution doesn't take too long, so we'll run all our automated execution. But if our automated execution takes a long time, or it doesn't work particularly well and has a lot of human intervention, then we might have a subset and choose to run that. Essentially, what we're talking about is a subset of testing in an area that is not directly related to the area we've changed. Or it might have some impact, and that's why we're choosing to test it. So how did this concept arise? I don't like this concept, and I'm going to explore that. But how did this concept arise? Well, when we were doing waterfall projects, we had big, big projects, big, big systems that were taking years to develop, and we would develop a lot of stuff without actually testing it. When we started testing it, we'd find bugs. When we started using it, we'd find that the requirements weren't quite right and we'd need changes. So all that change work, new features and bug fixes, was all being done at the same time. There was very little development team testing. And remember, we'd split the team up into development team and testing team, and they were working independently of each other. The communication was pretty poor. There was very little impact assessment of changes in code. There's impact assessment of changes on a business level. How will this impact us? What we'll have to do to change our process? But we're expected to just code and get on with it. Very often there was very little impact assessment done there. The change tracking was usually very weak. We didn't always have version control systems that were particularly good. It was a long time between releases, so we knew what was being fixed so that we could then go away and adjust our test cases and scripts. Then they'd be ready when the system came, but sometimes the system would have changed our scripts and they weren't quite ready. The whole approach to development was just massive risk. And the test approach was very fixed on test cases and scripts and slow to respond to changes. So testing and regression testing naturally became about running stuff that we had already defined or agreed we were going to do. So it was about rerunning stuff that we'd already identified. Now, the problem with regression testing is that the system does not actually regress. The system does not move to a former state or a less developed state. The system is advancing to its next state, but there may be unexpected changes. When I said this at a conference, someone said, well, what if we were doing testing of a previous version? What if we've decided to roll back to an earlier version? Are we then doing regression testing? Because we've regressed to a former state. So you could call that regression testing if you wanted to. What I would suggest you do is that you call it migration or rollback to an earlier version testing, and then see what risks there are in that process, and then target the risks, because testing is really about risk. When we use the term regression testing, we're kind of obscuring the risk. We're just saying, well, something might have changed, therefore we'll run some stuff in some other areas. If it's automated, we'll just run everything again. Otherwise, who knows what will happen. So if we redefine regression testing in terms of risk, then what we're saying is that there's a risk that a change has had an unexpected impact on another part of the system. So that doesn't mean that we have to use testing as our only mitigation strategy for that. How else could we mitigate that risk? Right? We could change our development approach to help with this. We could re-architect it to allow us to build in smaller components so that when we make a change in one component, there's a reduced risk of change in another one because it hasn't actually changed. And then if we do all the interface testing and integration testing around that, perhaps it will work. Perhaps we can architect to avoid this. Perhaps we could have better version control. Perhaps we could have better change tracking. Perhaps you could build in smaller increments. Perhaps we could, what if we did TDD? Would TDD help? TDD means writing tests in advance of writing code. Therefore, if we change the code, presumably we're writing tests for that. Therefore, we'll be testing the new changes. There's a risk that if we don't do TDD and we just write code, that we write new code that is not actually covered by the existing tests. So the existing tests only help us when we're actually doing TDD. But also TDD is very focused, doesn't deal with the notion of unexpected change further down the line of using the component where some data might have fed through into it. So then what about acceptance test-driven development? Acceptance test-driven development tends to take a bigger view and is expanding across components. So it might help. But again, what we've got is we've got acceptance tests, which presumably have been automated, which cover a specific set of criteria. The changes might be outside that criteria. So it might not overlap with what we've already decided is covered in there. So we might still have to do something else. Acceptance test-driven development, if it's actually driving development, can help, where we write the acceptance test and we write the criteria and then we automate the criteria for those changes, then presumably it'll go through the flow and we've actually got automated execution across that, which longer term will help mitigate the risk of changes impacting it. BDD isn't supposed to be a testing process, but has a side effect that we automate a lot of the assertion criteria in the same way we do with acceptance test-driven development. So again, it might help cover it, but there's no guarantee if we're not driving development with it, where we're actually covering those new areas of functionality with the automated execution or assertions of the acceptance criteria that we're about to build. So test automation in general might help. We might have covered some of those areas, but it may not be covering the changes we've made. So again, there's a risk in there. So any time we're faced with uncertainty, the only thing that really deals with it is a new set of analysis, a new set of working out what we have to test and how we're going to test it, a new set of ideas. And you can either go through your formal, let's look at the change and let's do test ideas, test cases, test scripts, whatever else, or you could do exploratory testing on it, because exploratory testing does that by default, comes up with new ideas, looks at the risks, looks at the system, figures out how to test it. When we're dealing with unknowns, we either go back to the start of doing our test analysis, or we do exploratory testing, which incorporates that in the process automatically. But we've still got the issue that because there's uncertainty, we don't know if our exploratory testing is going to cover those areas. So we still have to really properly mitigate the risk by understanding the system and its flows and the usage and the change. And then hopefully we'll identify the flows through that are at risk of this new area of functionality that we've added downstream. So the more we can understand, the more we can reduce the scope that we're going to try and test against, the better off we'll be when we come to this concept of regression testing or mitigating the risk of unexpected change. Now, the legacy view is simpler, right? There's a risk of unexpected change. We pick from our agreed set of scope. We recover that scope. Job done, right? There's very little hassle there. It probably doesn't reduce the risk very much. There's still a huge risk that we haven't actually covered it because it's new functionality, but it makes things seem simple. So we've got a nice simple term like regression testing. In the modern age of software development, we have to do better than this. We have to get back down to the notion of risk as informing our testing, looking at the uncertainty around that risk to try and identify how much we need to test this. Because when we test, we're trying to reduce uncertainty, but as we test and we learn more, we're also increasing our uncertainty because we're identifying new risks, new areas of uncertainty, new conditions that we haven't covered, new data scope that we haven't hit. And we have to constantly balance this and build a model of our risk and uncertainty, what we've covered, what we've not, what we know, what we don't know. It's harder, but it's also more important. And that's really the essence of testing. Put risk back in, redefine your terminology so that you're not just relying on old legacy notions of, I'll just rerun my stuff again. And we constantly have to think, because if there's a risk, we want to identify the easiest and fastest and best way to mitigate that risk as part of our test process. So that's regression testing. I hope that helps. If you're doing this in any kind of exam or job part, use the terminology, because that's what everyone's going to expect. But in your head, start reducing your reliance on this kind of legacy vocabulary so that you can constantly start from first principles, look at risk, and adapt your process, your test process, your testing ideas and approach to the actual needs that are in front of you at this point in time. And a constant focus on risk and uncertainty will help you do that. And the notion that exploration is what leads to new ideas and new coverage will help.